and welcome to another episode of Teppou Republic. Last time we saw the continuation of the assault on Innerbug Castle, taking heavy losses as we went in, even with the enemy forces depleted, but successfully capturing the castle in the end. Then over in Echigo, we cleared up the situation, defeating a small Sado army and pushing the larger Sendai Vanguard army back away from Echigo itself. In Inaba, the Yonago and the Matsue were trying to send forces east towards our undefended provinces. Takahisa caught up with the larger Yonago force and engaged it in battle. He positioned his troops on top of a hill and then used a perceived artillery advantage to force the enemy forward into attacking his position. And because he had missile superiority, the enemy's charge was gunned down and we were able to wipe out any threat from the Yonago being able to head east. In nearby Bizen, Takayuki was besieging the castle, but I called it off, seeing how Inaba was a very costly victory for us to win, and Takayuki's situation was even worse, so I'm going to head back and perhaps resume that campaign in the spring. Then in Echigo, the Sado landed another small army. Takamichi has just moved to engage it. The enemy's army is fairly decent but small, but does have naval artillery supporting it, so we'll need to be careful. So much already achieved, and yet still the end is not in sight. And these achievements remain so fragile, and any moment a breakthrough could end this revolution and turn the people's minds back to the way they must secretly still long for, the misguided nostalgia. I hope the reader understands that I was the first to volunteer to fight this war, even when I didn't believe in the cause whatsoever. But there is in fact a limit to both the glory one can win and the satisfaction one can gain from crushing one's enemies. Eventually, the smaller problems start to seem greater than the joy. Bad food, bad weather, and well, bad company now that I seem to have been made the de facto minder of the puppet General Kunimitsu. So it is me too now that seems to have that blasted nostalgia, thinking back to the time before the war in Iga, when I was free to travel the lands of our allied lords, free to dream of a war that would make my life worth living. And here I am, waiting for it to end, seeing my soldiers killed and replaced by the month, taking the burden of all the good and all the bad. The question that Father would ask is this what the people really want? He would surely say yes, but having spent a year fighting on the front lines, I can't say I've met many people who really want all this, no matter how many votes we get in some sham assembly as a result. Writing about this angers me, so I'll stop now. Maybe next time I'll be in a better mood. So Takamichi is setting up his forces, ready to attack the Sado. The Sado are going to attack us, in fact, as we have an artillery advantage, but the enemy of course have that naval artillery which we're going to have to contend with. At first, the enemy are moving their formation to go and sit behind a hill, at least most of the left part of their formation, meaning my artillery is going to have reduced effectiveness against their men, so a good decision from them. My own forces are setting up on a hill of our own, setting a multiple line formation so the enemy, as the enemy advance, will be able to get multiple lines of shot on them at once, which will overcome the enemy's actually pretty decent line battling infantry. I'm going to try and use shrapnel shot to cut down some of the enemy's regiments as they march. The shrapnel shot will be slightly better against these regiments because they're somewhat in cover, because the shots spread out and hit a wide area. So even if it's hard to hit them, and shots landing too far forwards or hitting the crest of the hill, we'll still just about manage to kill a few enemies. You can see here I targeted their cavalry as well, because they do have a strong cavalry component which could charge my lines. The shrapnel shot does do some extreme damage, as we saw there, but not enough to stop them. Really, it's going to be a line battle that decides this fight. However, before that happens, the enemy are going to hit me with their naval artillery. You can see they started by targeting the very top of that hill represented by the flare. So I'm going to start scattering my men to get away from that position. The question is, have they done a narrowly targeted bombardment, or is it a wide area fire for effect sort of affair where the shots will just land all over the place? If it is that, the current position I put my men in won't help me because I'm still pretty close to the flare. I'm sort of hoping they went for the confined bombardment that will just hit the top of the hill, so I've simply moved my men to almost the bottom of the hill. to hopefully avoid that bombardment, and that seems to be working. You can see many of the shells landing on top of the hill. One of them lands very close to our men there. It doesn't actually kill any of our guys. There's blood on the floor, so apparently they were wounded, but they get back up and rejoin the battle against the enemy's advancing forces. So all of these shots that could have been landing on my forces have just landed harmlessly on the top of this unoccupied hill. Perfect for me, although the fact that I had to move forwards means I've given up my really nice position. I still have an okay position and have forced the fight to happen a little bit earlier, which isn't quite to my advantage. The enemy's cavalry here are attacking my left flank, but I'm repelling them with a charge of Yarikachi and my own cavalry in the area ready to threaten them. I'm pulling all of the line back as well, because I want to try and get them back into the position that's more ideal for me, and definitely try and get two lines firing at once. As I'm falling back, the enemy's cavalry advance, not taking any fire, of course, because I was moving. As a result, they slice into my lines, charging uphill, which will reduce their power, but still able to do some pretty big damage. I actually didn't notice this happening. As you can see, my own cavalry just sitting there watching it occur. I think this replay was actually slightly corrupted, because I seem to remember I did respond in some way, but you'll see they'll just slice through my lines for the rest of the battle, which is unfortunate. Now the rest of the enemy's cavalry has been pretty much routed, and now the main fight is beginning as they bring up all their rifle attendants to do a line battle with my own line infantry up on the hill. The enemy have perhaps a slight advantage in terms of man-to-man power, but we definitely have a terrain advantage, and the fact that we're in a double line means we will generally get more fire on the enemy. Plus the enemy are doing a phased advance, which gives us the opportunity to get more shots on them as well. The enemy cavalry have actually almost broken through here on my right flank. Their general has added his weight to the fight, and these spearmen are just standing here, not reacting at all. I like to believe I would have reacted. I did actually do this battle a long time ago, so I can't say I definitely did. But fortunately for this replay, these carbine infantry are just cutting down the enemy's cav at close range, so we still got rid of them. Now you can see here my regiment's been very much decimated here on the right flank, and actually the battle suddenly ends in a close defeat, so there was something wrong with this replay. At the very least, it was missing the end of the battle where the rest of the line battle was happening in the center. But you can see the enemy's regiments are by this point actually outnumbered and are in pretty precarious positions, so I hope you'll believe me that I actually did manage to win this battle, although of course once we get back to the campaign map we'll see the true results. You have gambled away the strength of our position. It is one thing to send convicts to fight the Shogun's war, but to commit our own men to battle in such an inexperienced manner is cause for shame unheard of in your family. And now there are few left at home who know a rifle from a spear. Surely the Sioux will seek to punish us for our actions. The seas that have always protected us suddenly seem a lot more narrow now that the only able-bodied warriors we have are the occupants of this room. We are forced to make a decision. Beg the Sioux for mercy, or beg the Shogun for protection. Perhaps it doesn't matter either way. So here is the real result, a decisive victory, and it looks like none of my regiments have lost quite as many men as we saw the guys on the right flank lose there, so I'm sure I must have done something about those cavalry. Anyway, the main result is that the Sado force is gone, so their second landing army, which has attempted to attack Echigo, has just failed. Of course, it'd be really nice if I could counterattack Sado Island, but the enemy have a huge naval advantage, which essentially makes them invincible for all intents and purposes. I can't possibly land troops on their land because they control the seas completely, and in fact they control all of the areas where I could build ships because they've already destroyed them and are just continuing to do so every time I repair them. So overall, a bit of an annoying situation, but it's safe for now. The Sendai seem to change their invasion plan, invading not down the road but down through the wilds in winter, which will cause them serious attrition, which I'm very happy with. The Matsue, who were pressing east, come into Tajima. They don't attack the castle. Instead, they attach a detachment of mortars, which was just sitting outside the castle. For some reason, I can't reinforce with any of my forces here actually coming from the castle, so as a result, it doesn't look good. I tell the mortars to flee, and the Matsue do not pursue them. So overall, a strange situation, but at least it's stable there. I've got one more turn to deal with them. The Odawara are raiding forces into Echigo there, but only a very small army, so nothing really to worry about. Something that is a bit worrisome is that Takehisa was apparently almost killed by a Yonago ninja. It could have been trying to kill the foreign veteran in his army, but I imagine Takehisa was the true target for this high-level ninja. A very dangerous situation. We need the Yonago to go away because they do have an agent advantage over us, particularly in this area, so if they want to spend the money, they could do some serious damage to us. Now the Matsuri army, which is suffering attrition outside Tajima, is just going to stand there and wait for me to react, but I'm not really going to react. I am going to turtle up because I want the enemy to just waste time wandering about through my provinces in winter, taking losses, not able to take any of my castles because of the garrisons, even if that means losing some of my infrastructure. In Harima, there are two enemy armies about to cross the strait into the province, it seems, but I have two of my own, as we just saw, ready to receive them, so I'm okay with that situation. Some of the men who I don't think are really needed in Harima, I'm going to try and send back towards Mino using the train network, because they can join a new army that I'm constructing at Owari, and then come back in force to reinforce the area. There's a bit of trouble with the train network there. It has a very strange user interface. Actually, my guys had no movement points, so they can't use it anyway. Now for Takahisa, I could have gone back to attack the Matsue, but what I really wanted to do was move south into Mimasaka, because I was sure the Yonago would barely have any forces since we've beaten so many of their armies recently. And indeed, it looks like that is the case. Mimasaka is ungarrisoned. So I'm going to move Takahisa down to attack it. Strangely, I can't do it with the foreign veteran standing on the road, so I have to get him out of the way before I attack. The balance bar is quite far in my favor, so it looks good. I wanted to see if I could get the foreign veteran into the army before I attack, because he does provide a few bonuses, but unfortunately he couldn't. But anyway, we're going to go into the attack. Takahisa's army, not actually at full strength at the moment, but still easily enough to take this lightly defended province. So an auto-resolve gives us a heroic victory, losing a couple of hundred, defeating over 1,000, and Mimasaka is ours. So now I'm going to spend the rest of the winter defending this area and trying to get his force back up to full strength. We've now got full stacks pretty much across our western frontier, guarding all of the possible enemy approaches. So I'm pretty safe against Imperial invasion, although of course they can bypass these defenses using their navy if they want, and there's really no way for me to stop them if they did do that, so that is still a worry. Now in Shimotsuke, Tananao's forces were actually not needed to garrison the province because public order was surprisingly good, so I decided to send him north to an ambush position on the border with Fukushima. I'm not going to have him attack because he'll have to march through several turns of winter attrition before he could attack, but being on the border ready to ambush may be useful. Now back in Echigo, you can see we've got multiple enemy armies to worry about. The Sendai have put themselves in a silly position off in the attrition zone, so I'm not worried about that. But I am going to take out this Odawara small army because it could raid my forces, particularly the railway station right next to it, which would be really annoying. So after ages gathering an army together from the garrison at Echigo, we attack them and they run away. I decided I want to put this army on the bridge because I think it will be able to stop the Sendai if they do try and come and cross the bridge, which will free up Takamichi, who otherwise would have to fight them, to start moving either on the Sendai forces or on the Sado. The latter option being somewhat difficult because of course I can't get any ships, the enemy will just destroy them if I try and build them, and as I said, they'll just destroy my ports if I even get an area that is ready to build ships. So instead, Takamichi is going to go into an ambush position to attempt to draw the Sendai back towards Echigo so I can ambush them with my larger force, but it doesn't matter if I don't, because of course I can fight a bridge battle if they decide to go around the southern route. Now moving on, the Satsuma Imperial Vanguard sent a single ship to attack Compton at the docks at Koachi, and it turns out that this ship is an ironclad of their own. This ironclad is going to be reinforced by the many navies that are essentially blockading Compton in this location, meaning it's been stuck here for a very long time. I have only one support ship, a corvette, but my crews are very experienced, and of course my ironclad is technically better than theirs. Theirs is a specialist artillery-esque ironclad that specializes at engaging at very long range, whereas mine is more like a traditional corvette. So it's going to be some ironclad on ironclad action. Hopefully Compton can hold out in this battle, because I really don't want to lose him after all the fights he's been through. The main advantage I have is that these coastal guns on the land here will be able to fire at the enemy if they come close enough. The problem though is that the enemy's reinforcements appear to have arrived on the map right next to my deployment zone and behind me. So first I have to scramble my ships to turn them to be able to engage these enemy ships. Luckily the enemy having trouble, as you can see, these two corvettes turned into each other, meaning neither of them could turn properly and get their broadsides to face me. So whilst they're stuck there, I can hit them with explosives, and a lucky shot starts a massive fire on the engine of one of the ships and it immediately surrenders. So one of their reinforcement ships is lost straight away. Now they only have two coming in behind me. The other one here is actually quite damaged already from previous attrition, so that should be okay. The other ship that's coming in really behind us also is isn't turning to face us with its broadside at the moment. There is a danger here that I'll hit myself with friendly fire from my corvette. It could fire into the ironclad, so I'm trying to be careful about manually targeting these units. And you can see here the second corvette has surrendered. Again, a huge fire on its engine decides that they're not going to fight anymore. So now I just have to deal with this guy. This ship is in a much better condition to start with, but you can see it's just sitting there, not reacting at all to the fire coming from my ironclad. And at close range, this explosive shot is going to be nice and accurate and should be able to start some fires on their ship as well. Meanwhile, the rest of the enemy's force, these frigates, are just sitting at a big distance, hitting me with standard shot. There's nothing I can do about it because they outrange me. They can just sit here and fire, and it's the same deal with their ironclad. Here it is. You can see it's sitting, pointing right at us because its gun is actually on the front of the ship as a single large gun that is just firing at us from a big distance. The gun is relatively inaccurate, but when it hits, it does big damage. You can see here a single hit has destroyed 3 of the 12 guns on my ironclad and killed a bunch of the crew. Very dangerous.
So they want to tighten the noose on us? A real shame. I was starting to enjoy their company. Handful of ships and a few dozen guns? Ain't nothing me and the boys haven't seen before. That big nose fella they brought might just be worth something to get out of the bunk for. I guess they were keeping it for a rainy day. Never thought that they would realize that metal was a damn sight better than wood when it comes to staying ship shape under fire. Probably learned from me. Looks like we're gonna have ourselves a seaborne battle of boats, a duel over the deep. Too bad for them, I don't feel like losing today.
So the other ship coming in behind us is continuing to take explosive fire and is now wavering. They're on the verge of going. The ironclad is a clear advantage, and still they haven't turned to fire back. So the enemy, I guess, forgot about that ship. They're just wasting it, essentially. My corvette has pushed forward a little bit to try and get some shots off on those frigates, but I'm not going to keep them in combat. You can see I'm turning them away. I want to pull them back as close to land as possible, really, to try and draw the enemy close to these coastal guns. The enemy has such an advantage in terms of number of guns that I need to get these coastal guns in range and firing to start evening the odds. Unfortunately, these coastal guns are a tiny bit glitchy. They often don't fire when they're actually in range, and it just says firing at will, but they're not firing, and you can't actually control them. They just act as independent agents. So I just have to hope that they'll bother to fire at the enemy if I can draw them towards me. My corvette isn't doing all that well, of course, because it's taking fire from 2 frigates, and it's now going to present its back to them as it runs, so it could take some pretty hefty damage. The good news is that the enemy corvette coming in on the edge here has now been gotten rid of. Again, a huge fire has started. They decide to give up. Their hull was also seriously damaged by all the fire it was taking. So the ironclad has triumphed over those 3 corvettes. I can now join the fight against the remaining ironclad and the 2 enemy frigates. This coastal battery here has finally got proper line of sight on one of the enemy's frigates and is going to hit them with volleys of standard shot. They're quite inaccurate, especially firing at the maximum range as they are here, but hopefully the frigates will start to take damage from them slowly but surely. So I'm trying to pull both of my ships back towards the land, as I said, but unfortunately for me, that requires a little bit of fiddling around and presenting my back to them, and as you can see, a lucky shot from one of the enemy's ships, probably the enemy's ironclad in fact, hits the corvette. The corvette's completely destroyed. The explosion happened at the worst possible time because my ironclad was right next to it, so it damaged the ironclad as well and set fire to the ironclad. Very dangerous indeed. I now have to scamper away and try and repair that ship and put the fires out to have any chance of continuing this battle with a chance of victory. You can see the ironclad actually almost routed, but its level 9 crew held on there. Luckily for me, the enemy are doing something relatively stupid again. They've got their 2 frigates here guarding the ironclad, 1 frigate blocking the other frigate's line of sight, although neither are firing. I think they're out of range. And the ironclad's just sitting there. I think the frigates want to move forwards. Eventually, they manage to sort that out. They've got 1 frigate guarding the ironclad and the other one coming off to start firing broadsides at my ironclad, though luckily it's curving around in the perfect path to take fire from my coastal batteries. So with all of the guns, there's probably about 18 in total firing, they do actually start to get some hits, and we start to do some pretty considerable hull damage to one side of the frigate, and that frigate actually starts to fall back and try and get out of the way. But as it does, the enemy's ironclad and the other frigate come into range of both my ironclad and the coastal batteries. We managed to set fire to the frigate at the back, although it doesn't stop to repair it, it's just going to plow on. I thought I might try and set a fire on the enemy's ironclad, but I think this is very difficult to start fires on ironclad, so it's not really going to happen. Really, I'm just relying on the coastal batteries to do damage to the enemy's hull. The enemy can't really fire back in this position either, because this type of ironclad doesn't really have broadsides. It has the big gun on the front, and it has two guns on the front at the side that can do very small broadside attacks, but neither of them have line of sight on me at the moment. So we can just keep pounding at the enemy's hull as it comes across. Eventually, it gets to the other side of the map and turns to bring its large gun to bear against my ironclad, but by this point, it's taken loads of standard shot, and you can see the side of the ship there is really battered. Its armor has been relatively broken, actually. The bad news is that now it has point-blank firing opportunities at my ironclad. Its very powerful gun can tear through the armor on my ship if it manages to hit. So it's essentially a gamble that it will keep missing, and you can see, as by the explosion pot marks in the hill behind my ship, it's relatively inaccurate, so we're doing okay, though my ship does look a little bit battered from the engagement so far. At least we're going to be able to engage with them at point-blank range as well. And you can see that, much to my delight at this point, the enemy ship is starting to list. The armor that's taking heavy damage on the side is leaking water into the ship. You can see it's only at about half strength there, and the ship is gradually going to be sinking. The enemy could attempt to repair that damage to prevent the sinking, but they're not going to. You can see it has a very slight list to the right there, but that's only going to get worse and worse because they're trying to engage with me, still firing shots and not attempting to repair the damage. So this is perfect. I'm going to keep the gamble going, hope the enemy keeps missing my ironclad, and I'm still getting opportunities to fire back and hasten the sinking process. The water's now almost up on the deck there, but the enemy still refuses to repair. It's too late at this point anyway. They're definitely going down. The front of the ship submerges underwater. The guys at the back hang on, not really attempting to abandon ship until the very last moment. You can see they had a couple of Gatling guns there for close range engagement, but they are not going to ever be used as that ship goes down to the briny deep. So we've defeated the enemy's ironclad. This makes things a lot easier for me. It takes a lot of weight off of my chest because finally I can stop worrying about the constant artillery bombardments it was providing. So now we just have to take out those frigates with what we have left. Half the town came down to the batteries to help out. They had all lost loved ones to the Imperial bombardments over the months, and now they were finally close enough to strike back. Plus, everyone wanted to keep Compton in the fight, seeing as he's pretty much the only reason the enemy haven't leveled the town. So with all those people, we had plenty of runners and spare loaders and spotters covering all the angles. We kept firing and firing, and when we saw that enemy flagship disappear beneath the waves, there was a cheer like nothing I've heard in a long time. But still, the fight wasn't over. So with the ironclad gone, my life's going to be a little bit easier, but still not all that easy, because I need to deal with these two frigates, which of course have a massive advantage over me in terms of guns. Together, they massively outgun the ironclad. It's up to the coastal batteries, really, to take this guy down, especially because the ironclad has lost half its guns by this point, so is not in a particularly fit state to return fire. I am, though, able to get some explosive shots on the closer frigate, which has already taken damage, and you can see it starts routing, and then another volley of explosive shot causes it to surrender. So suddenly things are going in our favor, and the other frigate, which is still in good condition, starts to rout itself, or at least comes close to routing, is taking heavy fire from the coastal guns. This is a little clip of what I was actually doing, using the coastal guns in first person mode to guarantee hits, because they were being so inaccurate normally and not firing most of the time. So slowly but surely, I managed to destroy the remaining enemy frigate with this close range fire from the gun, and the battle ends in a costly victory for Compton's forces. Certainly something I can accept. We destroyed a large number of enemy ships, losing just one of our own, including an enemy ironclad. So overall, I think the game is being a bit mean calling it a close victory. In fact, here it calls it a Pyrrhic victory, despite only losing one ship and the enemy fleet being put to the bottom of the sea. So good news, our fleet survives and the enemy's fleet is gone, but of course the enemy have far more ships than that, so it's not a huge victory in terms of the total naval engagement in this area. The Satsuma move a land army towards Hanuma, and then the Sendai continue their advance into Echigo as we move on. Also, the Okayama forces move up, with more forces appearing on the crossing into Hanuma from the south, and the Urawara bring more forces into Echigo as well. So across all of our fronts, it seems we are being invaded. You can see here, four stacks are now queuing up to attack Hanuma from the south. The pressure is really coming on here. We can see this leading stack here has tons of light artillery. Wasn't too worried about that one. This other stack looks more more powerful, it's a more well-balanced force. They're bringing wooden cannons, which will reduce their movement range quite a lot, so at least that's good. And the Okayama and the Satsuma have forces coming from the west there, so Hanuma's really under siege. Of course, I've got my two stacks here in the forest waiting to receive attacks from the south. I wanted to know if the enemy knew about them. It looks like the enemy know about Takayuki's force and one of these two stacks, but the other one apparently is unknown to the enemy. So I'm going to try and move that in front of the path they need to take to hit Harima itself. Hopefully one of these two groups will be able to ambush the enemy so I can fight them one at a time rather than engaging them now where I'd have to fight a two-on-two battle. For Takayuki, I'm going to do pretty much the same thing. I hope that just by moving him very slightly, the enemy might lose track of him, and he'll still be able to ambush the Satsuma if they come along the road, which it looks like they will. I'm also going to evacuate the loose artillery that I don't need back to Mino, where, as I said earlier, I'm going to join it up with these forces I have here in Owari, a new Republican army under construction. In Echigo, we've got these two groups coming into the province from the north. It'll be a while before they're really a problem. One of them is just a load of Shogatai, a very interesting army. The ones to worry about are these forces down here, especially this Sendai army, although it's mostly cavalry. Very strange, but actually that plays fairly well to the fact I was planning to block it out using this force which is going to hold the bridge, because that force has loads of pretty decent spearmen who'll be very useful for stopping the enemy's cavalry if they just try and charge across that bridge. I still wasn't completely confident in them though. I wanted to move some artillery from Echigo itself up to support them. You can see their movement range makes it look like I can almost get to them, but in reality they can't actually get close, so I'm not sure what that movement range is doing there. But still, it looks like next turn I'll be able to link those two armies up, and it might even take a turn for the enemy to attack, so that could be okay. For Takemichi's force, I'm just going to continue moving it north, putting him in another hidden position, still coaxing the enemy to come down that road and be ambushed by him if possible. I'm going to do another ambush plan over here near Inaba, where the enemy have a few stacks guarding Hoki. I didn't feel like attacking during the winter, so I thought I would just leave Inaba pretty unguarded, and then Kudemitsu's army can sit in an ambush position on the border. So hopefully the enemy will start moving in and I can take out those small stacks. That will be very easy. So, going into the next turn, the Satsuma decided to make another attack against Compton and his ironclad. Unfortunately, it hasn't been repaired, meaning it's still in bad condition, and it will only have 6 guns in this battle. The enemy have brought up a damaged frigate and have 2 more ships coming in as reinforcements, a frigate and a corvette. The balance bar's pretty even, but of course my ironclad has low hull strength. If it gets a little bit lower, it's going to start sinking, and as we saw for the enemy, that could be disastrous. We'll see what happens next time. So that's all for this week. We'll see Compton's battle and the ongoing defense of Harima next time on Teppou Republic.